Right, good morning all of you. So in this session we'll see the design procedure of journal bearings, some of the empirical relations related to the design of this hydrodynamic journal bearings we have already discussed in our earlier sessions. Now here we'll see the steps to be followed in designing the journal bearings. Right, so the first step in the design of hydrodynamic journal bearing is to determine the bearing length by choosing the ratio of L by D ratio from the table. So we should keep our data book with us, so while solving these design problems. Right, so first you need to select the suitable L by D ratio based on the given application. Right, so in the problem you will be given application, whether it is centrifugal pump or a motor or whatever it is. Right, so based on the application, first you have to select the suitable L by D ratio from the design data handbook. Right, then check the bearing pressure. Bearing pressure equation, P is equal to bearing load divided by projected area. L into D is the projected area. And check this bearing pressure value from the tabular value. Okay. So whether the selected L by D ratio satisfying the design considerations as far as the bearing pressure is concerned or not. It is to check in the second step of the design procedure. First, you have to select the L by D ratio. From this L by D ratio, you calculate the length of the bearing. Right? Once you have the length of the bearing and diameter of the journal, you can find out the bearing pressure. Since the bearing load is given in our problem, bearing load divided by this L into D gives the bearing pressure. Now, you have to compare this calculated bearing pressure value with the standard bearing pressure available in our data book for the given application. If the calculated bearing pressure based on these L and D values, if it is less than the data book value, then the design is safe as far as the bearing pressure is concerned. Hence, the selected value of L by D ratio is correct as far as the design is concerned. Okay, then third step, assume the suitable lubricant. Assume the suitable lubricant from the table or from the design data handbook, right? And its operating temperature, T naught. Okay, generally the operating temperature of the bearing should be in between the 27 degrees centigrade and 60 degrees centigrade. So operating temperature is nothing but T naught. The temperature at which the bearing operates is known as the bearing temperature, right? So this bearing temperature generally lies between 26.5 degrees centigrade to 60 degrees centigrade. Okay, and the maximum value of this bearing temperature is also given for high temperature applications like steam turbines. It should be maximum of 82 degrees centigrade. It should not cross beyond this upper limit of 82 degrees centigrade. Under normal conditions, under normal installation conditions, the bearing temperature lies between 26.5 degrees centigrade and 60 degrees centigrade. Okay. Then once the lubricant is selected for the given application, determine the operating value of Zn by P. The operating Zn by P. Zn by P is bearing characteristic number. You can calculate the bearing modulus and compare the bearing modulus with the operating value of Zn by P and check whether the bearing operates under hydrodynamic conditions or not. Check the value of Zn by P to determine the possibility of maintaining the thick film of lubrication. if there is a thick film of lubrication between journal and the bearing, then the bearing operates at hydrodynamic conditions. Okay, so that is the fourth step. Then fifth is the clearance ratio, C by D. C by D is the clearance ratio, diametral clearance ratio. And you have to select this diametral clearance ratio from the standard table available in our design data handbook. Once you have these values, you can find out coefficient of friction mu by using the standard empirical relation. What is the coefficient of friction equation? Coefficient of friction mu is equal to Zn by 33 by 10 to the power of 8 into Zn by P into D by C plus K. Plus K, that is the standard empirical relations. This we already discussed in our earlier session. Then determine the heat generated. Determine the heat generated using the standard empirical relation. Heat generated formula is Hg is equal to mu into W into V. Hg is equal to coefficient of friction into bearing load into the velocity of the rotational velocity of the bearing. Rotational velocity of the bearing. Then calculate heat dissipated from the standard empirical relation. What is heat dissipated equation? This is equal to Hd is equal to Ca into Tb minus Ta. Ca into Tb minus Ta. Determine. Next, you consider the thermal equilibrium of the hydrodynamic journal bearing to see that heat dissipated is equal to heat generated. Whatever the generated heat is completely dissipated by some means in the hydrodynamic journal bearings. If these two are not equal, then the thermal equilibrium will not be attained. If there is no thermal equilibrium, obviously some extra heat generation takes place compared with the heat dissipation capacity. Obviously, you need to consider different measures to remove the extra heat generated in the bearing so that you can avoid the thermal deformation of the bearing. So that means to keep thermal equilibrium, okay, heat generated must be equal to heat dissipation. So in case the heat generated is more than the heat dissipated, then either the bearing is redesigned or it is artificially cooled by either water or sometimes artificial cooling by some other oils. Okay, so this can be considered by taking heat Q is equal to M into S into T, MST. Q is equal to MST, where S is the specific heat of the coolant oil, whether it is a water or some other oil, whatever it is. Okay, so this is the design procedure of hydrodynamic journal bearing. Okay, like our rolling contact bearings here, we'll consider these 9 steps in the design of hydrodynamic journal bearing. First one is selection of L by D ratio from the data book. Based on this L by D ratio, calculate the length of the bearing. Once you have the length of the bearing, you can find out the bearing pressure, load divided by projected area, L into D. Once you have the bearing pressure, you check this bearing pressure with the standard bearing pressure of bearing for the given application. Okay, then if it falls within the range, then obviously the selected L by D ratio value is correct. If it is exceeding the standard bearing pressure value, obviously you need to go for reselection of L by D ratio. Reselection of L by D ratio. Then once we have bearing pressure values, then the next step is selection of lubricating oil. What type of lubricating oil is suitable for the given application and its properties, lubricating oil properties like the bearing lubricating oil operating temperature, then similarly the viscosity of the lubricating oil, all these properties you need to consider here. Then the fourth step is determine the operating value of bearing characteristic number. Okay, this is also first you need to select the operating value of bearing characteristic number for the given application from the data book. Once you have that value, then you can consider standard operating value, and you have to check this with the bearing modulus. You have to check with this bearing modulus. Okay, so if the bearing modulus is less than the operating value of Zn by P, then you can maintain thick film of lubrication. Obviously, you can say that the bearing is works under hydrodynamic conditions. Then fifth step is selection of C by D ratio from the data book. Then determination of coefficient of friction, heat generation, heat dissipation from the standard relations. Whatever we have discussed from our earlier sessions. Then you consider the thermal equilibrium. That means Hg equal to Hd. If these two are not equal, external cooling must be considered. Amount of external cooling considered is calculated by taking an equation Q is equal to M into S into delta T. Okay, so that's how the bearing, hydrodynamic bearing can be designed. Okay.